Hello sir, for welcome
Very
address.
good morning to one and all. On the occasion of national webinar on aquaculture today, dignitaries participating and sharing their expertise and knowledge, most respected honorable speaker, Professor Ayyappan sir, he is only charge of DG and secretary there, ICR New Delhi, next present chancellor of Central Agriculture University Manipur. He is going to speak on impact of COVID-19 in fishery sector. Or another learned speaker, Dr. Ninawe sir, ex scientist G, advisor to DBT, Government India New Delhi, is going to speak on avenues in fish processing industry, and well-known entrepreneur Dr. Manoj Sharma is going to speak on management strategies of shrimp farming in post-COVID-19. Is holding director of Mayank Aquaculture Private Limited, Surat. All participants register more than 250. They are from ICR, State Agriculture Universities, entrepreneurs, companies representative, and my dear students. We know all are facing problem of COVID-19 being pandemic has challenged our life. However, video conferencing as an ultimate solution to connect with remote workers, students, and employees, and at the same time, it prevents direct contact. If necessary, as per the normal guidelines, we have to follow preventing direct contact, then social distancing, sanitization. So, to prevent this direct contact, we are using this national webinar through this our video conferencing, which will connect our people. We find that there is disruption in the seafood supply chain, falling production and decreased consumer demand are already pushing up the price of fish and aquatic foods, which means many people will lose their job. Those who can instead rely on subsistence fishing and fish farming may have a chance of weathering this crisis. In this context, the webinar is organized by inviting expert speakers in their field to provide evidence-based insight to save government authorities and policies to keep operating value chains in safe way. General advantages are also for aquaculture farmers. Lastly, I must congratulate convener of this national webinar, Dr. Smith Lende, and his team, especially Director of Information Technology of Kamdhenu University, Dr. Aditya Patel, for taking paying for excellent arrangement webinar and giving us chance to meet all of you with modern gadgets. And thanks to all learned speakers for sharing the knowledge. Thank you very much. Jai Hind, Jai Jai Garib Gujarat.
Thank you very much, sir, for wonderful welcome address. Now I request Dr. Ayyappan sir to have his presentation, sir. Welcome, Ayyappan sir.
Ayyappan sir, are you online, sir? Ayyappan sir,
hello.
Ayyappan sir, you start your presentation, sir, please.
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much. In not of him, madam.
Yeah, please, sir.
You can start your session.
Yeah, are you able to see?
Yeah, we are able to see you. We are able to hear you clearly.
Okay. Good morning and greetings to all of us, and grateful for this opportunity at this time when we are all going through this pandemic of corona. The Kamdhen University has started this unique initiative. I'd like to at the outset congratulate the Vice Chancellor, Dr. Kelewala, and colleagues, Dr. Smith Lende and Dr. Aditya Patel. Thanks to everybody. I hope I am audible. I am clear.
Yeah, you are very clear, sir. Very clear.
Okay. So, colleagues, thank you very much, and for this opportunity once again. And I'm aware that I'm speaking to my colleagues and with years of experience in fisheries, aquaculture. So I may not be able to bring anything new, but I thought I would share a few concerns at this time. And also the title is made like this, Fisheries Aquaculture Towards 2030, because it's only 30. Yes.
Yeah, participants, hello? Please keep your mic off.
The Kisra presentation is Abhi Paila Chalpa.
Hello?
Abhi Lagega.
Yeah, yeah. Participants are requested to keep their mic off.
Yeah, can I go ahead?
Yeah, yeah, you are here. But someone mic is on, so there is a disturbance.
Okay, can I go?
But we cannot have the master control. We can mute all the participants.
We have to mute one by one. Yeah, all participants, please keep your mic off so that Ayyappan sir can proceed. Please.
Okay. So, friends, thank you very much. As I said, this is titled as, another 10 years. Now, this title is intentionally made. You are all aware of the Sustainable Development Goals 2030. So, it started 5 years back. So we're all going in full speed to achieve those goals. And this corona, COVID-19 has come as a shock to the entire world. So now the concern is, can we go ahead in the same speed or should we do something? So your kind attention for about 45 minutes as I go along with these slides. So as I mentioned, the Millennium Development Goals, MDGs, we are all very familiar. And it went on up to 2015, and 15 to 2030, we have the Sustainable Development Goals. 17 goals, whatever we do in our economy, whatever activity that we have, we align ourselves with these 17 goals. And one of them very clearly, goal 14, I'm sure you are able to see the screen, the goal 14, life below water, is absolutely referring to fisheries and aquaculture. And in general agriculture, you have as many as 7 goals that are aligned to the SDGs. Friends, it's good to have a comprehensive view because, we have been working in sectors, sometimes in silos, and that has created problem. Today, this pandemic has brought us together in every single activity. In the real sense of the term, now the population of more than 780 crores on this planet, and each one of us is struggling, as you are aware. And it's also good to have an idea of the food production. It's more than 3,000 million tons, and then we are aware. It's good to have also an idea of what the food spectrum is. That's why these few slides will give you an info on the global food production system. So more than, you are seeing some of these, I won't read all of them. Now, as we go along, the Asian perspective is very important. The food requirement to 2050, we have been working out, it is at least 50% more than what we have today. And along with that is the climate change, the malnutrition, the urbanization, the aging rural population.
Excuse me, Ayyappan sir.
Yeah.
Hello. Yeah, please continue, sir. Please continue.
Yeah. So along with that is the aging rural population, and we have these disasters. and never a disaster like the COVID-19 we are having, except the Spanish flu a century back. No, we need to get prepared to all this. And apart from this is the food loss and waste, more than a third of that we produce. मैं हिंदी में भी बोल सकता हूँ, अगर किसी को जरूरत पड़ा तो, जितना हम फूड प्रोडक्शन करते हैं उसमें एक तिहाई भाग वेस्ट हो जाता है. तो ये सब मद्देनजर रखते हुए we have to keep all this in mind. And you know the Asian population is nearly 60% of the global population. And we are looking at some of these things about how to balance the entire food production system with the due reference to the environment. And today hello, Dr. Anina. Today, friends, more than hunger, the food safety is also becoming important. You would appreciate the coronavirus is being attributed to some wet market in China. So now the problem is from the production level, from the pond, from the oceans, from the lakes, from the rivers, you know, the kind of food, the kind of fish that we produce, the quality becomes very important. So today, more than hunger, the food safety is becoming very important. Now, kindly look at this, what is happening today with reference to healthy diets. They have to be sustainable, affordable, accessible. It should be safe food, nutritious food. And it is in this context, we are bringing up fish as a very safe and nutritious food. Friends, we should also look at this, what we are looking at the global hunger map. And as you can see here, the India stands at the 102nd rank out of 117 countries when it comes to hunger index, with a score of 30.3. Quite a serious hunger situation. So we are worried whether the coronavirus pandemic will push us further. But I must tell you, whether it is KPMG or the Moody, their assessments are impact of corona is much more on the industry and service sector than agriculture. So this is one silver lining in the clouds that we are facing. Friends, again, the point is with regard to the climate risk that we are running. India is the fifth most affected country and the subcontinent in the whole world with reference to climate risk. Now, we have been producing food, plenty of food, but then today the concern is it is with reference to water and energy. Whatever food we produce, what is the water footprint? What is the energy footprint? It's always accounted for. So that brings us to new paradigms like today. More than 70% of Indian population is having less than 50% of the micronutrient requirements. 50% children underweight. 80% women in reproductive age are anemic. Now these are a few things that we are getting worried. And that's why we are bringing a fish up front as a protein food, health food. As you can see here, only about maybe 10% of the children, Indian children, are having minimum acceptable diet. And please bear in mind, we are one of the youngest country in the world. The population in the 18 to 35 years age is more than 60%. So the future has to be catered to. Very roughly, India is more than 18% of the global human population, 15% of the livestock, on just 4% of global water and 2% of the global area. And when it comes to agriculture, just about 1/3 of the country is cultivable. And there also, we have not been able to make full use of the lands that we have. There are issues there, and then I won't go into those details. But the point at this time is, more than 50%. Dr. Nina, let me more than 50% of the Indian population is dependent on agriculture. Agriculture, friends, let's be very clear, as per FAO definition, any food production system, terrestrial or aquatic is agriculture. So let's not get into this, you know, debate whether agriculture is only crops. It's entire, all food is agriculture. Now, what are we doing today? The entire contribution of agriculture to the national GDP is only about 14%. And of that, please also remember 1% comes from fish, 11% for the total exports, and 17 to 18% of the agricultural export is from fish. Now, I just intentionally wanted to put this picture before you. Kindly see the first picture at the left is Mahatma Gandhi and Madan Mohan Malviya, founder of BHU, Banaras Hindu University. Hello? Hello?
Mute kaise karna hai? Kya ho gaya?
Hello?
Your WhatsApp khole kya aapne?
Nahi.
Hello? Hello, Dr. Smith, can I continue? Hello?
Sir, has you unmuted?
Yeah, please continue, sir. Please continue.
Okay, because I hear some voices in between. Okay, now why I'm putting up this picture is how important agriculture is to this country. Both Mahatma Gandhi and Madan Mohan Malviya underwent a dairy training in Bangalore in 1927. So it is that important. They came here for 2 weeks. So starting from that, you are seeing how the agriculture is being projected and promoted in this country. The other picture is of the father of Green Revolution. We all know him, the Nobel laureate, Norman Borlaug. Now you can see him discussing with the Prime Minister and going to the godowns of this country, and this is how we have come about in food production systems. I am projecting this slide, don't worry about the details, but just the point is what we are producing today is about 290 million tons of food grains. And I'm coming to fish also in a minute, but the point is more than 800 million tons of food in different forms, food grains, in terms of vegetables, fruit, milk, meat, fish, egg, and so on. So this is what it is. It is more than 800 million tons of food, though always the press says, media says, only about 287 million tons. So be sure we are talking of 800 million tons. Now, what are we looking at? Hunger in India. As I already mentioned, these are a few aspects for your notice, for your consideration. But as we move along, we are having some problems in agriculture, in farming, and then there are many issues that we would like to discuss. But at this time, our point is we have to shift from production to productivity. Don't worry about that. At that time, what we are in the agriculture university system, in ICR, so what we are doing here, whatever research we do, we try to reduce the cost of production. If the cost of fish production, say for example, in case of carp, in Andhra Pradesh, is for example 45 rupees, if it is a tentative situation. So we try to make it, can we make it 40 rupees? So this is what we are interested. So in agriculture R&D, the idea is to enhance input use efficiencies and reduce the cost of production. Friends, now this is what it is, the total food is about $400 billion. And of that, livestock and fish is about $90 billion. Now, you are talking about 800 million tons of food, I told you. 11% of global production, one-fourth of the Asian production. But what we require to do is, in another 10 years, we have to absolutely increase it from about 290 to 350 million tons. Now, you can understand the problems, climate change, biotic stress, natural resource degradation, urban migration, you are seeing in corona pandemic context, how migration is happening. So these are all the things. So in this context, as the World Economic Forum discussed, can we bring transformational changes? Like today, we are talking through these media, Skype, Zoom and all that. We never thought we can do it. But then these pandemics, these stresses, these crises only push us through two good technologies, high-end technologies. So that's what is the interest. Now, our strength today is biodiversity. 10% of the global biodiversity easily, more than 12% of flora, 7% of fauna. But at the same time, there is the pressure on the natural resource base is very huge. Now, friends, you're all hearing for the last 5 years, we had to double farmers' income. and that's what we were trying to do. But in the last 3 to 6 months, we have been badly hit due to various things. Now this way, we are talking about integration, diversification, clustering, cutting costs, adding, enhancing input yield efficiencies. And in the bottom, you see what we are worried is mostly nowadays safe food, nutritious food, wholesome food, quality assurance, traceability. More worrisome feature is antimicrobial resistance. Whatever you do, from fish to humans, whatever we do, shrimp, for example, I'm sure now our colleagues, Dr. Manoj Sharma and others would speak about it. Antimicrobial resistance is really killing us at this time. So the future of food farming is not just the field crops, it is the horticulture, livestock, fisheries, agroforestry, and all that that we need to consider. Now today, the new agriculture is more from less for more, starch to protein and health food. It is stress agriculture, and that's why we are talking of a continuum. See, friends, we never talked of a continuum. If it is fish, I went on promoting fish, somebody went on promoting fruits, and it went on. But now the requirement is a continuum of agriculture to food, to nutrition, to health, to environment and employment. So if we don't have all this, nobody would buy our enterprise. And that's why we need to look at enhancing the agriculture GDP as we go along. Now coming to specifically fish, you are aware the annual fish production latest is about 13.7, 13.8 million tons, and 65% coming from the inland sector. And of that, 80% is in culture, and we are at about 6.5% of the global production. And the growth rate is interesting. When you look at the composite, annual growth rate all put together, we should be happy while agriculture is total will not be even 3%, 2.5, 2.6, 2.8. Fisheries, aquaculture, mainly aquaculture, has been registering anywhere between 6 to 10%. And today's export earnings also are nearly about 50,000 crores, about 48,000 crores. And that's what we are going with full speed. But now last 3 months have brought in several limitations that we have to address. The global trends, many of you are aware, and then I need not go into those details, but agricultural GDP, the fish contributes about more than 5%, more than 1%, as I said, to the national GDP. And globally, the fish consumption, you are aware, and this is where we see opportunities. And now in the change scenario, in the next 6 months, we have to get fully prepared, whether it's a hatchery or a processing plant or a fishing unit. Everybody, we have to see new opportunities post-monsoon, how we can get into real fishing activities, the way, I'll come to those, some of those slides after a few minutes. Now at this time, we know the global population trend, 9 billion by 2050, and presently the global production, fish production, is about 171 million tons. And the requirement is in the next 30 years, easily 240 million tons. And India has to go from 13.7 to easily something like 25 million tons. They are the projections. And capture fisheries, 91 million tons. And then our Indian situation, not more than 4. So can we look at aquaculture in a big way? So as we go along, the globe looks at aquaculture as 140, and then aquaculture production from India, because capture fisheries cannot go beyond 5.5, whatever. So India still has to cater to the 25 million basket, so more than 20 million tons. Now these are challenges as also opportunities. Now this is where we are looking at what can we be doing for the total thing, keeping your average per capita consumption. Maybe it's only 12 kg in the country today, but there would be greater demands for fish as we go along. Even among the animal produce, fish would be absolutely at the top as far as demands are concerned. So it is too familiar, I won't go into these details. The Indian fisheries resources, 8,000 kilometer coastline and reservoir that we have, all these, it's common knowledge for you. Will be our utilization. I will also talk of the aquaculture, the genetic resource we have, and how much of it we have put to use in till now in different systems. Now, when it comes to fish diversity, You know, this is where we are forgetting. Most of the time, we are getting into enterprises, but then the basic resource for us is the fish biodiversity. The finfish recorded as on today, 2,500, of which the freshwater ones is about 877. You are seeing that, and exotic about 291. So we are dealing with something like 2,800 species of finfish. That's the biodiversity that we have. When it comes to shellfish, the crustaceans, you know, freshwater and marine, nearly 3,000. The molluscans, more than 5,000. So these are all the biodiversity that we have in this country that we can be using as we go along. Fortunately, several countries, several states also have bought this interesting picture of the state fish and so on. Now, friends, for a minute, I'll just change to one more presentation. Just bear with me. I'll change to one more presentation. Just bear with me for a while, and I'm getting into the other presentation. Just changing the presentation quickly. I'm sure you are still able to see. And I'm going through them quickly. I'm coming to that particular slide. Yeah. Now, as we go along, our paradigm today is, I just mentioned to you about what all happened in case of the biodiversity. So now our concern is, state fish is one thing very interesting. And at the same time, you know, this gives an opportunity for people to conserve. Now, our looking to the seas paradigm in the whole of agriculture is becoming very interesting with the two island systems. And this is where you have, you know, our present estimate is 3.5 million tons. And we have said about 4.5 million tons. But let's not worry about the data just now. But the point is, we can be doing some of this, pelagic, demersal, and you are all familiar with these things. So we are now talking of the exclusive economic zone. How much could it be? Could it be 3.8 million tons up to 100 meters? And how much beyond? How much should be the deep sea fishing? And how much is the investment? These are the discussions going on. And in this context, the climate change impact is being duly monitored. The movement of fish populations from southern the southern seas to the northern ones, and then also the relevant fishing regulations that we require. And I would like to bring to your notice the fisheries policies. You are familiar, but just to have a recap, say fishing charter policy of 81, 86, 96, 2004, all that you are familiar, 2013. Then we had the national policy for marine fisheries, very recent one, 2017, and inland fisheries policy, 2018. And the most recent one still in the parliament is the National Marine Fisheries Regulation Management Bill. Very comprehensive, putting together everything. Also interesting is the Aquatic Animal Disease and Health Management Bill, 2019. And the latest one is National Mariculture Policy, 2019. It's not even approved. It is in the draft stage. Now the concern is, post-COVID, what should we be doing? And that's where we request inputs from everybody, from policymakers, from researchers, from academicians, from our colleagues in the industry, from the farmers. Now, what should be the fisheries aquaculture policy post-COVID-19 in this country? It's an opportune moment because these two bills, 2019, you are seeing, are still in the policy stage. So we have an opportunity to give our inputs. Now, what we are worried today is our data is itself requires a relook. Then regulations between the states. Deep sea fisheries, you are aware of it. Restricted zones, still a lot of discussions. The riverine fisheries and then the water flows, all those things, you know, you are aware between the forestry departments and the fisheries departments. And even sometimes irrigation power and so on. The canal fisheries, almost that we are not used at all. And the reservoir fisheries, easily a doubling production possible. Now the other problems are with regard to biosecurity. I'm sure, you know, in this post-COVID era, this will receive utmost attention. Earlier we had discussed national security protocols, but then now the aquatic biosecurity and quarantine, even between the states, might become very important. Similarly, disease reporting, many times, you know, we are not serious. And now you know how countries dealt with corona. Some people reported, some did not report. But how it can lead to a global disaster, we are all aware of that. Earlier also we have seen our white spot disease, I mean, all those kinds of things. Even recently, last month, we are seeing yellowhead disease incidences. We are seeing, you know, decapod incidence virus coming in. Even last month in coastal aquaculture. So the point is, like they are kind of testing and treating, tracing and all that. In aquaculture also, this kind of a tracking, tracing, testing and all that would become very important. Similarly, seed certification, disaster management, I mean, these are some of the things that we need to go address as we go along. Friends, when it comes to marine fisheries, we can still do a great deal of things. Ocean fertilization has been described, high value compound. Why should we be only talking of 4 million tons of fish? Why not, you know, the wealth of the seas could be utilized for startups and enterprises and so on. Similarly, domestication of species, I mean, these are things that you are reading. I won't go into those details. Look, having said that, like we already have been running climate change workshops. Now, should we also take to COVID workshops in the coastal areas as we go along? In the next 2 years, already we are planning a few things like restoration post-COVID. Like when tsunami happened in 2004, everybody got together, networked, and worked for post-tsunami the restoration for nearly 2 to 3 years. Now, I'm sure, you know, friends, you would appreciate we would need to do a similar thing. Some of us are already getting into this planning mode of the workshops, capacity building, similarly sea level raise intrusion that we had discussed, and climate resilient and mangroves at this time, how they would be behaving, what kind of population densities are there around mangroves, and what should we be having, the measures with regard to post-COVID is important. Mitigation, as an example, I brought it. Whenever, you know, the tsunami happened in Orissa, this is what we did. You know, we took to restoration measures. Should we be doing similar? That's one question for the coastal areas. Now, when it comes to aquaculture, friends, you're all familiar with the canvas. And then in aquaculture, we again look and have the mariculture potentials. We are talking of some of these. And in mariculture, you know the species, candidate species, whether it's the letters or the cobia we have been working with, and breeding protocols, standardized, or it's the classical oyster and the mussel farming that's going on. Mussel farming, it could be in Goa, or the lobster culture we did even in the state of Gujarat, in Veravel for the tribals, and some of these had picked up as enterprises. Now, post-COVID also, I'm sure you would appreciate, we need to do a lot of entrepreneurial interventions to have those livelihoods restored and also enhanced. Enhanced, that is very important. And it is in this context we are talking of sea cage farming in different places. And similarly, it could be seaweeds. Now we had the seaweed sanitizers brought about in the context of COVID just recently. And then some of these things you are familiar. You are seeing the photographs, so I'm not reading each of those. Now, what is the possibility in mariculture? Present production is only of the order of 1 lakh tons, 0.1 million tons, let's be clear. I mean, maybe a little more or less. But the point is, hatcheries, they have to be enhanced in a systematic way. We have to have these brood banks properly. Now, although the RAS systems, the integrated, you know, tropical aquaculture that we are talking about, so yeah. Biomitigation.
Excuse me, Ayyappan sir, can we have your presentation also? Can you share your presentation also?
Yeah, it's not seen.
Yeah, no, you need to present your screen on the bottom side, like the previous previous presentation.
Oh, sorry, that's why I asked you. Chinyo. Yeah.
Like you shared the previous presentation, please share it.
Oh, sorry.
You're present now option. Present now option.
Present now option. So from that time, you're not seeing?
Yeah, yes, sir. Yeah. You need to present your screen.
Okay. Then I'm doing it. I'm so sorry. I'll show you some of the slides very quickly again.
Yeah.
Are you seeing now?
No, sir. No. You need to present your window.
Yeah. I'm seeing. Are you seeing?
No, sir. Yeah. Now we are. Yes. Yes, sir.
Now
we are able
coming,
to see your presentation.
Okay, now in that case, I'll quickly go through what I said very quickly. I won't take much time. See, I had covered up to this state fish, but what I spoke was with regard, I'm very sorry, I thought it's being seen there. Now, this is what I mentioned, these are the slides I just spoke about. Then climate change, the marine fishing regulations, the policies I mentioned, this is very important. This is where, you know, we are talking about the post-COVID policies. Is it clear now? I mentioned all these, I'm just showing the slides. Is it clear? Is it being seen? Is it being seen?
Is it being seen? Yeah, clear. Your presentation is
yes,
clear.
Yes, sir. It's clear.
So I'll quickly go through, run the slides. I've already spoken about them. The climate change workshop, the climate resilient food crops, the mangroves that I mentioned, the aquaculture, the mariculture portion I was speaking to you, about the oysters, the mussel farming, then the mussel farming that I spoke, and also the lobster culture I mentioned in Veravel, in the Gujarat coast. And I was just mentioning that for the coastal livelihood restoration enhancement, we need to do a great deal of this, and the seaweed, you know, this is what I just mentioned. Now, speaking about this slide, post-COVID, we are looking to mariculture in a much bigger way, and then further, the due hatchery support systems and so on. When it comes to coastal agriculture, a lot of things are entwined in this, and we will take a holistic approach. It cannot be just aquaculture, because the saline lands at 50 kilometers from the high tide line, people are worried about livelihoods now. So this is where we talked about the potentials, and then the shrimp, that's too familiar, some finfish that possible, and also the diversification. Post-tsunami is what happened. Many of these were brought in as the restoration measures for livelihoods, and they readily took to it. Now, when it comes to culture-based fisheries, these are the meat of the, you know, the whole thing. More than even today, nearly 8 million tons of fish coming from aquaculture, fresh water aquaculture, and so on. And some niche markets like organic aquaculture, people are talking about it. Now, we need to also bring in some of these specialized areas, so, you know, we stand to gain with a higher produce and higher market and a higher price, and so on. But friends, the point is at this time.
Yeah, please keep your mic off, participants. Hello. Yeah, please keep your mic off, participants. Ayyappan sir, you can proceed.
Okay. Now, friends, what is being discussed is today, globally, people talk of carbon footprints. Whatever may we do, whatever we produce, immediately people talk of how much is the environmental damage. So, in that context, carbon footprints has to be duly given credits. Now, we have been looking at carbon sequestration. Now, one is what is the carbon we produce, carbon dioxide, the greenhouse gases that we emit from our aquaculture ponds and so on. But then we're also bringing up this dimension of the carbon sequestration potential. And this also has been discussed, carbon credits to the farmers, how we can be talking of. So our researchers would need to give attention to some of these areas, quantify the greenhouse gas emission, at the same time, quantify the carbon sequestration. And in that context, we have to bring in different levels of because one coastal aquaculture, one vanami will not suit the entire. So we are having the entire country with saline lands, you know, across. That is again more than 8 million hectares. So now we are talking of low cost technologies, we are talking of inland saline science, we are talking of, you know, as I said, low saline water technologies, high saline water technologies, and so on. So now coming to the summary of this coastal aquaculture, 9 coastal states, 2 islands, 65 districts, all this. So you are seeing that other statistics, I won't read it. But the point is, more than nearly two crore people are depending. And in fact, we estimated 1/3 of India may be in the coastal areas in different forms. need not be only in fisheries, but in different forms. So that is why we are talking about how the shrimp, not only shrimp, diversified coastal aquaculture can become an option, not only for food production, but as an enterprise to bring in, because these youngsters, displaced youngsters, are looking for new opportunities. So can we look at all this? Because the slide is in front of you, I won't read this. Now, friends, I just want to bring your kind attention to one aspect of the aquatic genetic resource. I mentioned to you what was in the earlier slide, I mentioned to you what were the the species diversity, 2,500 species of the finfish, 2,900 crustacean species, 5,000 molluscan species. All of them will not come to aquaculture. We know that all of them are not edible, all of them are not scalable and all that. But still, just for your information, in aquaculture, the utilization percent use of finfish globally is 1%, but ours is only 0.5%, not even 0.5%. So can we increase it? That's what is the interest. And when it comes to molluscans, it is globally it is 0.2%. We are 1/4 of it. So can we increase it? Crustaceans similarly, they were done slightly better. Now this is for your kind consideration. The entrepreneurs and the researchers, we have to join hands to see that our aquatic genetic resource utilization in commercial aquaculture goes up. That is the interest. Now here, for example, very quickly. For India, all these, Tilias, Elasmobranchs and all that. So this is how we are using. But now our concern is for the next 10 years, for the next 20 years, can we diversify our culture basket? If not all, as I said, from 0.5%, can we increase to 1%? That means the efforts of last 40 years have to be compressed to next 10 years. We have to be much more active in breeding, all those domestication, breeding protocols, hatchery protocols, seed production, all of that. So it's a lot of challenging work where research has to be scaled up, entrepreneur, the networks have to be formed, the academia industry interface has to highly get increased, startups have to come in, incubators have to play a role. So this is for your kind attention. Similarly, this is with regard to molluscans, same story. Except some oysters and bivalves, they are not used much. So can we do something? If not for food, and let me tell you, it's not for food, but it's for the high value compounds, highly high potential areas with regard to molluscans and crustaceans. Now this is what we are looking at, the acclimatization, the fecundity growth, broodstock availability, nutrition profiles, market acceptability, disease risks, and our main intention is, can we intensify? Earlier we were extensive, semi-intensive and all that. But the future is, we have to go vertical, we have to go, you call it whatever, super intensive, whatever. But that's the way forward, given our resource crunch and the way we have to deal with the industry. Not to be shy talking of intensive farming as we go along. Now at this time, what are we looking at? What are we trying to assess the situation at this time? So many, as I said, many agencies have put forth their projections. For example, KPMG, for example, Moody's, for example, World Bank, the IMF. All of them have been releasing. FAO also has released a few things: impact on agriculture, impact on fishery, and so on. But this very quickly. Now we are fishery and aquaculture. We are at risk definitely, but then we are still safe. When it comes to local, regional, global systems and all that, we are still safe. That is first point. Second point is, we are looking at fishing, culture, processing, transport, logistics, marketing, producer, buyer, seller links. What is the impact of COVID? In the last, say, let's take February as the, February 1st as the starting point. So February, March, April, 3 months' time. In 3 months' time, what is the impact? Now, when we look at fishing, the reduction in fishing activities, definitely it has happened. There are concerns on sanitary measures, both on board and off board in the port, in the landing centers. There are limited supplies, and then labor shortage is all seen. So the way forward is some ideas, some suggestions by taking from FAO and other agencies summarized is, one is, can we designate fishers and crew as essential workers that are dealing with food? Every country has accepted anyone dealing with food system is taken as an essential service. Secondly, we can't be, even today's lockdown, starting from, announcement starting from 4th, there also interstate movement is still restricted for another 2 weeks. Now, what we are talking about is, can we have the fishing center with community kitchens closely linked? It could be food assistance, midday meal scheme for institutional use, for prisons, for hospitals, and so on. So can we have the supply chain customized sooner than later with the district administrations taking these on board? That means we don't do fish long distances. That will reduce our expenditure also, and then make fish transport safe. Then maybe some discussion is required. This is what we are telling the governments also. We need to extend the fishing seasons this time. Because in agriculture also, many exemptions are being brought about. Next is fishing quotas, and then some kind of quotas and minimum floor price, and then also local food security considerations have to be there. Then when it comes to aquaculture, international markets are getting closed. There are cargo restrictions. Then next we are talking about food services, retailers, inputs of seed and feed, difficult to keep stocks for long times. So in this situation, what can we be doing? Sometimes, small-scale local aquaculture might stand to gain. So this is an opportunity. We need to immediately have whatever stocks that we have move to the markets. So that's why we are trying aquaculture at par with agriculture. Many state governments are relaxing. We should be very happy at this time. State governments are really responding with speed when it comes to farming operations, a procurement of pulses and so on. So similarly, fishing department, we are asking them to have some of these kind of things, even temporarily though, for any year, for 2021 and so on. Similarly, credit, microfinance, NABARD and so on, and then the domestic supply chains to be made more robust. When it comes to processors, market traders, there are reduced demands both ways, either reduced demand or panic buying, both are happening. Then losses due to quality, that is one thing. There could be issues there during transport, during storage and so on. So the additional cost for holding is becoming an issue now. So reducing the border restrictions, then stability of fisheries access and support to the supply chain. Then whatever fish we have not been able to sell, temporary processing, even with some eyes, whatever way of...
I think Ayyappan sir, connection is lost. Aditya sir, are you there, sir? Hello, Aditya sir. Hello.
Smith, what happened?
Hey, Ayyappan sir, connection is lost, sir. Right. I am trying to connect him, sir.
Yeah, please, he can join again.
No, because he was in the mid presentation. No?
Dr. Smith, can you call him and request him to join again?
Unhone call kiya tha.
Dr. Smith, can you call and request him to join again?
Sir, he is joining again, sir.
Yeah, please.
स्मिथ कितना बाकी था सर का?
पांच स्लाइड बाकी थे सर।
नहीं आने दो सर को, आने दो।
We talk with Ayyappan sir.
Yeah.
He is joining soon.
Yeah. Yeah, Dr. Smith.
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
Ayyappan
sir is.
Sir, Ayyappan sir sites there is a power failure.
Okay.
But just now power came back. Sir is trying to come at the platform.
Okay. Yeah. Please keep your mic off, Kiran Baraya.
Manoj sir, shall we start with your presentation, sir? Hello.
Hello. Yeah, Dr. Manoj Sharma. Can you call Dr. Manoj Sharma to start with his session, Dr. Smith?
Yes, sir. I am just calling him, sir.
Amit Mandal, please keep your mic off.
Sir, we will start with Manoj Sharma, sir, presentation, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Manoj Sharma, I think he has left the meeting. Can you?
Just I have talked with him. He is now presenting, sir.
Yeah.
All participants are requested to keep their mic off. Vikas Singh.
I'm bringing back the slide. Dr. Smith. Yeah, sir, you're online, Ayyappan sir.
I'm bringing the slides, please.
Okay. Please, sir.
Yeah. Are you seeing the slides?
Yeah,
now?
We are able to see your video. Now, please present your PPT.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can see your presentation. Please play the presentation.
Yeah. So I was thinking about
full screen. Please play the presentation in full screen mode.
Yeah, in the full screen. Yeah.
In the bottom side. Yeah. Click on the play button.
Yeah. So now is it okay?
No, sir. It is not in the full screen mode. No. The PPT is not in the presentation mode.
Not in full speed. Full screen in the thing. Even our hill one thing.
Our slow one, but the slower one.
Is it coming now?
It is visible, but not in the full screen mode, sir. Not in the play mode.
If you can
play on mode. That orange button on the bottom side, there is an orange button. Play button.
Orange button, play button. Orange button. Is it okay?
Yeah, it's fine. Fine, sir. It is visible. All are visible. Fine, sir.
Okay. Okay, now last few slides, I won't take much time. So now I was on this slide with regard to marketing strategies, and the next one is with regard to working conditions along the value chain. Now the problem is with regard to the crew working for long periods, chances of more hot spots, then mobility restrictions, and the risk for fish vendors. So this is where we are talking of safety by permitting only a few vessels with the complete safety measures, then unemployment assistance, then hygiene and sanitation in fish markets, direct cash transfers to vulnerable fishers, and mainly the inter-institutional coordination, all of us to come together for that kind of a enabling fisher movement and repatriation. That is one thing. Then with regard to management and policy, the problem is with regard to possible, now it's one good thing. There could be some respite for overexploited fish populations. Local producers might get better opportunities. And then also the fish monitoring committees, the fisheries monitoring committees, there may be less need for that. But at the same time, we need to enhance the remote surveillance, the non-observer monitoring programs. And as we know, the monitoring programs, at this time, there may be more of illegal, unregulated, unreported fishing. So whenever we talk of some of these, maybe we need to enhance. And very importantly, the partnerships at all levels. This is what we are now talking of. And when it comes to aquaculture, this is the last slide. When it comes to aquaculture, we need to look at the domestic consumption, workforce availability, stabilizing the market prices, then e-pass for aquaculture professionals, then lockdown exemptions as in food sector, then aqua farm input shops, that is important, financial assistance packages. So friends, these were largely a few things that I just wanted to bring to your notice. At the same time, there are a lot of opportunities. Some photographs are not coming at this time because the speed of the opportunities in agritourism. It could be innovations. The photographs are not coming, and we had brought some examples of how innovations could be playing a role. Many youngsters have got their success stories. For example, hydroponics or the recirculatory intensive systems, or simple interventions. So I just wanted to show you some of these photographs. Now, this is the opportunity for whatever we are talking of.
Innovation. Excuse me, Ayyappan sir, your PPT is not stuck. It's stuck on the same slide. Can you? Your PPT is stuck on the same slide.
Okay. Yeah. Which slide? Working conditions.
Working conditions along value chain.
Yeah. So now did you see the management policy?
No, sir.
Next slide is management and policy. Okay.
Sir, we are only able to see only one slide, working conditions along value chain. Can you present your screen again?
Yes.
Yes. Now it is, next slide has come up. Management and policy.
Maybe I'll keep in this mode only. This mode. Okay, next is with regard to aquaculture challenges. I already have spoken to you. Now, next is with regard to opportunities in terms of agri-tourism. Photographs are not coming because the speed of the internet may be here. Some problem here in this location. Then, with regard to the innovations that we are talking of. Okay, a lot of innovations that are happening, and that's where I wanted to bring to your kind attention opportunities for new technologies. Are you seeing this slight fusion of new technologies?
Yes, sir.
So this is where, friends, many people are coming up with these proposals. Big data analysis, IoT in farming, GIS remote sensing, image processing, artificial intelligence, sensors, robotics. Now, these are all things that are happening. Photographs are not seen. I know there is some problem because of the speed. But the point is, many people are interested in coming for interfacing with agriculture in general and aquaculture in particular. So our colleagues may be interested in some of these. And that's where we have many startups and incubators have started working on this. You would be surprised, in spite of all these problems, many people are online and working on some of these areas as solutions for input supply management and so on. Now I would close with a few, two, three slides, because I thought, you know, there are a lot of students here. So one slide I just wanted to bring to your notice was, there are many slides, but I would skip them. The agricultural education slide, that just wanted to mention here. At this time, 73 farm universities and nearly 500 all kinds of colleges and so on. But the point is, the intensity still is requires to be more students. The last slide is the research intensity in this country. You know, just to give an example, the overall global average is about 2,000 scientists per million. And in India, it's only about 216 per million. I thought this forum is important because we talk of COVID, we talk of pandemics, we talk of crisis and so on. But whenever, when many such things come, we are largely unprepared. We are not prepared. And now this world presently, we have seen a tsunami. We are seeing nothing less than a tsunami now. So both the natural disasters, man-made disasters, bio disasters that we can call. So we need to be prepared. And that's where we need to enhance research intensity, investments in research, and then more of higher education. So all these things are required. And I thought at this time, we should ponder over that issue also for the when it comes to the policymakers. So the last slide is, what are our projections as we go along in fisheries and aquaculture? Today, 2020, I'm sure you know you are able to see this slide. 2020, we are at about 13.8 million tons. 2025, it has to be, you know, in spite of the pandemic and so on. Can we really get to 20 million tons? It's a tall order. It's a very tall order. We would have gone in that growth rate, but 20 million tons, the breakup is also given. Maybe these slides are shared also between all the colleagues who are there today in the webinar, so they can read this. So these are the projections between marine capture, mariculture, inland capture, coastal aquaculture, and freshwater aquaculture. So there's a huge challenge. So by 2030, in another 10 years, can we really go to the 25 million tons? And that's what is the requirement, demand, and we need to get prepared for it. With these words, I'd like to thank you and apologize for the disturbances, interruptions in between. Thank you very much, colleagues.
Thank you very much, sir. On behalf of Kamdhenu University, sir, for sharing your valuable time. Dr. Kelavala, sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor, is speaking.
Sir, thank you very much for hearing this lecture from you. Really, we are encouraged. We gain some knowledge from you, and people like you always keep smiling and always share knowledge through these modern gadgets. Thank you very much. And I request all the parties have some questions, please, from the learning speaker. You are very much, I can say, sharing his knowledge, if you have any questions, please.
Sir, good morning, sir. Can I have a question from here, sir?
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Sir, this is Sundar Ray from CIFA Bhubaneswar. Sir, thank you very much for an excellent presentation and a new insight to fight COVID amid this lockdown. Sir, I have a question. Actually, sir, you might be knowing and you have made so many presentations. Our post-harvest loss in IMC is around 12 to 13% starting from the harvesting point to till it goes to the retailers. Sir, can you have some focus on this particular period by which you can minimize post-harvest loss to compensate the culture gap, because there are no seed production as of now in many states, like only West Bengal started late. So what is your views on minimizing the post-harvest loss, sir?
Thank you so much. As you said, you know, we had done two major studies across the food commodities, and we came up with an estimate of 6 to 18% in different food commodities. And as you said, the fish was easily to 15%. And our recipe were good management practices, good handling practices, and so on. And often, you know, they go on deaf ears. And a crisis like this, you know, it's in a way kind of an opportunity for us, where, you know, people already have become very alert. They are trying to look at, you know, every single stage of from the kind of, you know, stocking to harvesting. People already have come aware. And that's where I talked of a
few workshops and capacity building post-COVID. At least research institutions should get to this. So now when you talk to fishers, you would be surprised already the kind of care they're taking, you know, when it comes to handling each and every fish. So we think that, you know, in this situation, the harvest losses, of course, we require due icing, due packing, due all those. I think, you know, we should bring it down to 5% immediately in this COVID, post-COVID scenario. And these are big lessons for that. But then we require both individual capacity building. Second is institutional practices, good institutional practices, recommendations for handling fish. Thank you very much.
Sir, good morning, sir. Hello.
Yeah, please proceed.
Good morning.
Myself, sir, Rajdharesh Gopal, sir, you're a student. I have one suggestion from you, like cooperative society in this post-COVID era. What is your suggestion for the cooperative society, primary fisheries cooperative society and federation?
Absolutely, you know, cooperatives were discussed, and many cooperatives did not work. But also, you know, cooperatives have been a real issue, and a lot of things, other things, get into it rather than the technical aspects. But fortunately, now people are understanding that the standalone, I mean, of course, it is standalone is good for COVID management, but when it comes to the economic activity, standalone and you are doomed. They have to join hands. So in this, I mean, join hands, not physically. I mean, you know, you understand the language that we are talking. So now people have understood that right from, as I said, stocking to the market or the pond to plate, they have to join. So our suggestion is, one is it could be in the cooperative format. Our second is the food, the farmer producer organizations, FPOs, have done a deal of good in when it comes to other farming activities. Farmer producer organizations, FPOs, where there is less of bureaucracy. In cooperative, what happens? You have to have an election, you have to have a management committee and all that. Anyway, wherever cooperatives are there, they can be doing very well. Otherwise, now the alternatives are farmer producer organizations, commodity interest groups, if possible, and rest. Next to one good thing that's happening is that's the startups also. Startups, you know, agri startups also are coming in a big way, to mainly in terms for aggregation. Mainly for aggregation and then linking to markets. So I think we need to look at all these models now. Thank you.
Hello, sir. Sir. Hello. Sir,
hello. Sir, one question I wanted to pose at this moment. During COVID situations, you have suggested some of the measures, some of the points which the government should take up for fish farmers. Considering that point, what could be, from your view, would be the short-term measure, medium-term, and long-term measure?
Yeah, thank you very much. Now, short-term measure, as we are discussing in general agriculture also, the short-term measure is, one is to handle the stocks presently available. Now, there are two things. One is the marine fishing activity and the aquaculture activity. Now, aquaculture activity, again, the shrimp stocks that we are holding, and then the present, I'm sure Dr. Manoj Sharma will also be replying to this. Now, the shrimp stock that we are already holding, which we are not able to send out. Now, how to handle that? That is the first priority. Second is the fish stock that we are holding in ponds. So the immediate question is, can we have the domestic demand pushed up? Can we see that, you know, the domestic, you know, wherever retail outlets are there in the area, in the radius of preferably 10 kilometers, can we, you know, use all these stocks to meet that demand? And once the inter-district movement is starting already, maybe in the next 2-3 days, so there, that is one opportunity. The interstate movement immediately may not happen. So one is disposal of the stocks already in hand. Second is, except the present, you know, the brood stock that we are having, particularly when it comes to freshwater aquaculture, the brood stock that we are having for breeding operations in the coming 2 months. Now, how to handle that? How? Because the problem today is the feed management, the how we would procure the, you know, supplies when there is no money with people. These are all the things. That's where we are talking about the NABARD. Short-term credits, fast credits, you know, interest-free credits, you know, for all the registered. I mean, that's where we talked of the registration. registration is very important. Coastal aquaculture people, farmers, coastal farmers are already registered. But when it comes to freshwater aquaculture, a large number of them are still unorganized. So these are all things that we are suggesting the government to handle. As far as marine fishing is concerned, a limited activity is being allowed. And then we hope, you know, that will take up sooner than later, because come May 30, in another 15-20 days, close seasons are also coming in. So these are all things that we have to factor in. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any more questions? Participants? Any more questions for Dr. Ayyappan?
Yeah, sir, in the same thing, is there any measures we are suggesting for the women fish vendors?
Thank you very much for asking this question. Now, before men, you know, men, because the fishing activity was stopped for a while, they virtually were not, you know, were not in, they were kind of resting. But the women folk, all the same, they were still continuing with several activities connected to. So now that's very important. That's where we are talking of capacity building, awareness programs in some form or the other, like the post-tsunami operations, many of the NGOs to get into action. And one is with regard to their own, you know, self-health care. Second is with regard to disposals. And third one that is coming up is door delivery and vendors. I mean, there also a lot of women folk are getting in. So here, the due care to be established, and then what are the sanitization measures we are going to have at the aggregation points and at the delivery points. Now these are things that we are trying to put into a capsule for short-term training program, quick program, 1 day, 2 day program, and for their own safety, how they would be taking care. So these are all things that, you know, small NGOs can still do in the immediately. Thank you.
And sir, in the sir, one more question, sir. Just unable to restrict my temptation. Is there any measures you find, like use of the FFID, the funding scheme which was developed by installed by government last year in the finance program?
Yeah, thank you very much. What we see is, in general, in the agriculture department of agriculture, horticulture, and so on, that activity has immediately started. We are seeing on every daily basis. So similarly for fishermen also, some states have started doing it quick programs, and some I think will have to do it faster as we go along. Thank you.
Sir, this is M. Krishnan.
Yeah, good morning.
Sir, how are you, sir?
Thank you very much.
This is M. Krishnan from CIFP Mumbai, retired HOD of Fisheries Economics Division. I just want to bring to your attention, sir, there are several schemes which has been announced by the government in the post-COVID scenario to bring the various, you know, enterprises back on their foot. Like, for instance, the schemes which has been brought out for MSMEs, for the fishers, and the small loans which are available. But the problem which I see when I was giving some training programs to the various students, this particular knowledge is not being shared between the sectors. The bankers do not know about the fisheries. The fisheries people do not know about MSMEs. This kind of confusion is there. How can we bring all these people together?
Dr. Krishnan, thank you very much for raising this question. Today, fortunately, at the district level, the kind of coordination that we are seeing was unprecedented. You know, you are seeing between the law agencies, between the medical and so on. And similarly, agriculture is being appreciated by the district collectors as a very important economic activity. That's where, you know, we have been telling NABARD, for example, as you said, even within agriculture, the crop sector gets due attention, because procurement of food grains, pulses. Today I saw a number of things for the pulses procurement. Very good thing, immediate response. So same thing does not, milk fortunately is better organized. But when it comes to fish, you know the kind of unorganized thing. Now this is where we are trying to push that fish segment into agriculture. And fortunately the DCs at the top are duly taking note of this, food, because food system has become very important in this COVID, in the COVID management. So we hope, you know, this will be one lesson. But then all the same, I think the post-COVID restoration measure, what we are trying to suggest is, on a pilot basis, run these programs. So the bankers are also sensitized. What is important? So we can't be doing everything. but on a pilot basis, tell people how synergistic this is, and you should give due importance to all the food production systems. And hopefully, farmers, the officials, the banks, these people will get together. Hopefully, this will happen. But I'm sure, you know, with every crisis, we get better. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm audible.
Yeah.
Very good afternoon, sir. So I am Dr. Vivek Srivastava, one of your students from CIV. Currently, I am in Kamdhenu University, assistant professor.
Congratulations.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, first of all, thank you for the very good presentation. Sir, I have one question, right? Because we are living in the era now, means in COVID-19, and recently, like, we are going to get some sort of relaxation. But as far as concerned in fisheries, means so many farmers, they are talking to me like they means our that police and all these things, they are not allowing our trucks because that not is in priority. So this is one thing. So is the government is mainly making any policies that fisheries means from companies, some feed, seed and all this thing, this kind of trucks they will pass? And second point is this, sir, in processing means like farmers depend upon harvesting, and after that straight away these harvests are going to the processing plant. But in processing plant also we are seeing that so which are very close enough, and it is difficult to maintain social distancing over there, and the temperature also in the processing plant is quite low, which is anyhow means aiding this means influ and all the things. So sir, can a government or is government is thinking about the online marketing or some product development in a mass basis regarding fisheries, sir?
Thank you very much, Dr. Sir. First point is you said it right. That's where the very first point that we had put in the post-COVID management is consider fish farmers, fish workers as a part of the food system. They are essential workers. Throughout the world, food system has been declared essential. So at some governments are taking time to declare the fish workers, fish farmers also as an essential worker. So once that happens, all this inter-district movement and all that will be stopped. Now the police, what they do is they only look at essential items. Rice, okay. Meat, okay. They don't think fish is an important item. But the point is, for the farmer is very important. For the farmer, fish is very important. Perishable, and it goes away. So this is where some awareness is being talked of. Second point is very important. What are we going to do in processing? I'm sure you know Dr. Manoj also will speak about it. Very important point. In the coming 3 to 6 months, how are we going to handle fish processing, particularly as you said, cold temperature and air conditioning, refrigeration. These are all essential parts of fish processing. Now, the expectation is, of course, fish processors also are getting into it. Now, expectation is, can the domestic market be enhanced more? So that, you know, it's not to say that processing cannot happen, but then to see that as much as possible, the fresh, the iced maximum, the little frozen material would be disposed of. And as we go along, maybe, you know, we have to look at alternative measures. I'm sure, you know, our institutes also will have to come out with some protocols about the distancing, social distancing, and also this temperature management. These two things are still very important. I'm sure they're working on it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sir. If it's over, I'd like to immensely thank all the colleagues, particularly the Vice Chancellor, Dr. Kelewala, and our enthusiastic colleague, Dr. Smith Lende, and our colleague, Dr. Aditya Patel, and the entire fraternity who joined today, who gave me a chance to speak to you. Wonderful speaking to all of you. But the point is, let me again tell you, you have to give points. You know, like the last question was, how are we going to process in the low temperature condition? So like, you know, still many questions are unresolved. So now we have to contribute to this think tank and do something for this country and the society. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Your encouraging words, and your presentation will be shared to all the participants on the webinar website. There are many inquiries regarding your insightful, knowledgeable presentation, we will be sharing your presentation on the webinar website for all the participants. Thank you very much, sir.
Grateful. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you.
Dr. Manoj Sharma, sir, is requested to have a big presentation.
Yeah.
Can you see my presentation? Can you
see? Yeah, we can see your video, sir. We can see your video. Now, sir, remaining participants, please disable your mic and video.
Can you
yeah, see? Yeah, we can. Sharma, sir, we can see your video. Please present your screen also.
Present now. Can you
Dr.
see?
Dr. Ayappan, yeah.
Yeah.
Please present, share your.